Yes, so today we discuss the procedure of incision and drainage of the abscess. In the previous lecture, we already have discussed how to diagnose and how to and what is the principle of management of any abscess. So before that, starting the procedure, we should complete all the preoperative procedures that include the preparation of the patient, preparation of the operation theater, all our preparations, pre-medications, whatever required. And we should decide the anesthesia, what anesthesia we are going to put the patients. So according to that, we should do all the preparations. Most of the abscess, the outer abscess can be drained under the local anesthesia. Alternatively, that abscess is very severe, it's very deep, and the patients cannot tolerate the local anesthesia. In that case only, the general anesthesia or the spinal anesthesia may be required. Otherwise, in the local anesthesia is enough for the drainage of the any kind of the abscess mostly. So before giving the local anesthesia, first should wrap the patient, is just clean the local area wherever passes. You are going to do the incision and drainage. Clean with antiseptic solutions, the betadine 2 to 3 clean times, and then wrap that part and cover all the surrounding areas. Now, what is the principle of giving the any incision in any abscess? So the basic principle is that incision should be given at the most prominent as well as most dependent part. Most prominent part, why? Because the abscess cavity is likely to be ruptured in that from that area. So that should be the weakest part. So we the minimal tissue injury will occur if we do the incision at that most prominent part. And why the most dependent part is because most dependent part is the when we do incision in the most dependent part, that facilitate the complete drainage of that pus, whatever the infections or the dead tissue inside there. So that's why we should choose most dependent and most prominent part. But sometimes it happens that most prominent part, maybe not most dependent part. Understand? Just like in this picture, you can see the breast abscess. If this is the most prominent part, then it's very good because this is the most prominent as well as the dependent part when the lady sits in sitting position. So this will be the dependent part. And this is also the prominent part. So this is the ideal condition. We should give the incision here, linear, either cruciate. But if in this condition, in this lady where the abscess is in the upper outer quadrant, and this is the most prominent part of the abscess, outer upper quadrant, but this is not the dependent part. So in that conditions where most prominent and most prominent part is not in the dependent part, then then another incision is required to drain that cavity. That is called a counter incision. We already had discussed, and Sushta also had mentioned the principle of the counter incisions and what is the requirement of the counter incisions. So here we apply the counter incision because this, if we give incision in that part, this part. So this is the most prominent parts. Half principle is correct, but this is not the dependent part. So you cannot drain the complete cavity by this incision. If the cavity is big, then you have to give one here or somewhere here in the dependent part, so that this, by the gravitation, all the exudate materials should be drained in that from that opening. That is the counter incision. Understand? Now there is two things. Which type of incision should give? Linear or cruciate? So mostly we should give the cruciate incisions. if the cavity is big and we have to, because if the big cavity is there and we do the linear incisions and cavity is very deep, so the deep cavities will take larger time to heal. In the meantime, the linear edge of the linear incision will join together and form the and cause the bridging that will be the cause that will cause the delayed wound healing. That wound healing will be not proper. So that's why to avoid the bridging, we have to give the cruciate incisions, where just give the incision like plus. We will discuss in this next slide that how the linear incision looks and how the cruciate incision looks. So cruciate incision should be given in the largest cavity, and you can give the linear incision if the cavity is very small. After giving the incision, you have to break all the loculi inside. You have to excise first surgically and then mechanically and then chemically. All three type of debridements should be done: cleaning, surgical debridement, mechanical debridement, and chemical debridement. So surgical debridement, where you are going to remove the dead tissue, the dead present in this cavity, the fiber tissue, by the sharp instruments. Mechanical debridement is just you are not using the sharp instrument, but you are using the gourd piece in your finger, by your finger or any blunt instrument you are taking to remove that that all the dead tissue by the scraping. And the chemical debridement is there when after mechanical debridement, you are applying few chemicals, just like hydrogen peroxides, which releases the nascent oxygens that causes the frothing, and that causes the release of that oxygen-free radicals, which debride all the dead tissues present in that cavity, and the cavity looks clean. So that's why these three, please mute yourself. Whoever doing something, please. Kosoni. Okay, so all after giving the incisions, all three kind of debridements is required to do this surgical debridement, mechanical debridement, and chemical debridement. So by Hilton method, we discussed in last previous lecture that in Hilton methods, we are not using the surgical debridement, we are not using any sharp instruments, because the abscess cavity is nearby the vital structures. So there the only mechanical debridement as well as the chemical debridement should be given. So after debridement, you have to remove all the dead tissues, all the dead materials inside the abscess cavity. Then all the pus pocket should be breaked by the fingers, all the blunt instruments. Then the healthy pyogenic membrane, which is covering the abscess cavity, should be visible. Means healthy tissue should be visible. That completes the debridements. The same thing, so we avoid using sharp instruments inside the cavities. When the site of abscess is near vital, then we have to look careful and give only the mechanical debridement with the fingers and the blunt instruments. Careful look for any kind of the important blood vessels or the nerves. They should not be damaged. So after the cleaning, then we should use some antiseptic solutions to wash the cavity. Just like the betadine, we should wash the cavity and pour some antibiotic solutions, just like gentamicin or any other, just ciprofloxacin locally. And then we should use the packing of the cavity. Is very necessary to pack the cavity tight. First 2 days we have to pack the cavity with the gauze materials soaked in the antibiotic solutions, and just we have to pack the cavity very tightly. So the principle behind this to pack the cavity tight is to avoid any kind of oozing or bleeding inside the cavity, and just to soak all the exudates materials by this gauze pieces and avoid any kind of the bleeding. After 2 to 3 days when there is no bleeding, then you have to pack the cavity with a loose antiseptic, loose gauze pieces soaked in the antibiotic solutions, so that now you give the space to that cavity. You less apply less pressure so that cavity starts healing. Now you have to do the shodhana. Now for the ropan, for the healing, you have to give the space to the cavity. That's why you have to put the gauze piece inside the cavity. So whatever the exudation is there, that gauze piece will soak all that exudations. But it should not apply pressure over the cavity so that the cavity not contract. Understand? That's why you should pack the cavity very tight, and after 2 to 3 days, we should do the packing very loose. And I'm repeating again, do not close the wound with the sutures. If you are draining a pus from any cavity, means you are draining an abscess, then you should not close that wound with the suture materials. So here you should be just showing, this is the linear incisions when the cavity is small, and this is the incision, and this is the counter incisions. Because this is the prominent part, this may be the prominent part, and this may be the dependent part. So that's why we have to create a counter incision, and this is the cruciate incision. The incision just like a plus. First make one linear incision, then perpendicular to the previous one, we again mean a linear incision. Then we found the four edges, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. So we got the four edges, and we should trim this initial pointing part of this all these edges, so that they should not close early before the healing of the base of the wound. You know, the basic principle is the healing of the abscess. If it is healed from the base, it will be good. If it is healing from the margin or edge, then the healing will not proper and the recurrence will be there. So to facilitate the healing from the base, we have to trim the margin of these wounds. Now, if you just for the recap, the steps in the incision and drainage. First, do all the preoperative preparations. Then you have to take patient in the anesthesia. When the anesthesia effect is come, then you should wrap and give the incision. Incision should be on the most prominent as well as most dependent part. If it is not, then you have to give the counter incisions. And you can do the linear incision if abscess cavity is small. If the abscess cavity is big and deep, then you should give the counter, the cruciate incisions. Then you should start surgical debridement, means you should remove all the dead tissue surgically by removing from the scissors, cutting and scissors. Then you should give the mechanical debridement. And after that, you should give the chemical debridement by pouring some hydrogen peroxide in the abscess cavity, which releases the necessary oxygens, which cause the frothing and removing all the dead tissue adhered to the pyogenic cavity. Then wash the cavity and apply some antibiotic solutions, and then pack with the antiseptic dressings. ASD means antiseptic dressing. Initially, we should pack the dressing very tightly. For the 2 days, after 2 days, we should pack the cavity little loose, so we give the time that release the less pressure, so they give the space to the contraction and the healing of the abscess cavity. So these are the steps in the IND. So there are different type of abscess in the syllabus: abscess in the neck, axilla, groin, breast, popliteal fossa, iliac, gluteal abscess, deltoid abscess, and abscess sole on the heel. So these abscess present in the neck, axilla, groin, popliteal fossa, and the iliac. These abscess should be drained with the Hilton's method. It means We should not use the sharp instrument for the surgical debridement. Abscess present in the breast, abscess present in the gluteal region, deltoid region, we can use the surgical debridement. We can use the sharp instrument and we should give the mostly the cruciate incisions to do that. In the breast abscess, we should not give the cruciate incision because the scar looks very ugly. So that thing also keep in mind, because only draining incision and draining is not a responsibility. After incision drain, whatever the scar should be present. So the vaikatah paham is also the part of management, means you should also keep in mind that incision should look thin and incision should look not ugly in that patient. That's why to keep in mind, you should give the linear incision and mostly in the submammary area. So if the abscess could be drained in the submammary plane, so you should give the incision in submammary area so that scar should be less visible and less ugly. Now the pyemic abscess, we have finished the pyogenic abscess. Next, the pyemic abscess. This condition is characterized by the formation of the secondary foci of the suppuration infection in the various parts of the body. Means initial the focus was somewhere else, and after few months, the secondary infection developed in other parts of the body. That caused the pyemic abscess. Pyemic means infection. Mia means blood. Means when the infection is spreading to the blood. As I said in the second point, these foci are made by lodgement of the septic emboli consisting of a clumps of the organism, infected clots, etc. Means suppose a patient has a wound or had a large abscess in any part of the body, and after few days of that healing or that during process of the infections, somehow some infected organisms, bacteria along with some blood clots are traveled from that part of the body to the other parts of the body. And when these clots with the infected organism is dislodged any part of the other body and found some space and found in favorable environment, so that these bacteria again activated and causes the infections, causing the abscess. So that's why this is called the pyemic abscess, because mostly this infection is traveled from one place to another place, and usually this is the secondary infections causing from the main primary foci, and that's why it's called the pyemic abscess. This condition is usually associated with like the acute osteomyelitis, acute inflammation of the intracranial sinuses, or acute bacterial endocarditis. You know, these are the places where directly infection is not happening. Infection initially was occur in other part of the body, then later travel to the blood clot and infection then dislodge in that area, and that causes the infection in that part. So that this is that's why it is called the pyemic abscess. Now, usually the pyemic abscess are multiple numbers, because the infection is travel and it can occurs in multiple part of the body. So usually the pyemic abscess are multiple numbers, different parts of the body. Then there is three terms: bacteremia, septicemia, and toxemia. So they are just try to understand the difference between three terms. Bacteremia is nothing, just the flowing of the bacteria in our blood. Mia means the blood. Bacteremia means when the bacteria are flowing in our blood. So that is the condition usually occurs when body gets exposed to that infective organism, infective bacteria, and they are traveling in our blood. So that is condition is called bacteremia. Usually this condition has no clinical significance, means there is no clinical presentations, because as the blood that the bacteria comes in our blood having the inflammatory cells, that leukocytes, different type of the leukocytes, they just attack these bacteria and within few minutes, few hours, complete bacteria are engulfed, and the blood is again clean. But what happens? This is not correctly done in all parts of the body. If anyhow some part of the body bacteria are getting good environment and they are giving fight to that our immune cells, that's why in that case the abscess are developed. Then next condition is septicemia. Septicemia is condition where the infective organism along with their toxins, infective organism along with their toxins are traveling inside the our body. That condition is called the septicemia, means whole blood is getting infected and the infective infective organism as well as their toxins are present in blood. This condition is very much has the very much clinical significance, as in septicemic condition patient has the clinical features of the septicemia, just like Highgate fever, rigor, and malaise, body ache, generalized fevers, generalized symptoms, anorexia, all these kind of the features will present. And if the condition is very severe, the bacteria is very virulent, immune system is poor, then the condition, the patient of the septicemia may just land into the septicemic shock. Understand? Next condition, the toxemia, when the different kind of the toxins caused by the infective organism, bacteria, viruses, or any chemical toxins or other toxins are flowing into our blood, that condition is called the toxemia. That condition is also very clinically significant conditions, and patient here also will land into the shock. The different kind of the along with the septic shock, patient may go into the other type of the shock also, just like vesical shock. So means the three conditions: bacteremia, where the bacteria are flowing in our blood; septicemia, where the bacteria along with their toxins are flowing in our blood; toxemia, where the toxins are flowing in our blood, that may be due to the bacterial toxin, virus toxins, fungus, or other chemical toxins are flowing in our blood. So the clinical feature of the pyemic abscess is generally, we already discussed, generally these abscesses are the multiple numbers, and abscesses are usually presented subfacial pain, means below the skin there is a blood supply, the skin has less blood supply, but below the skin there is a fascia, and in between the fascia and muscles the blood supply is very good. So the pyemic abscess, because the bacterial organism are flowing through the blood, so that's why they are usually adhere in that plane, in the subfacial plane. Usually the abscesses are non-acute, means usually the sign of acute inflammation are very less. But in some condition, when the bacteria virulence is very, bacteria is very virulent, and the immune system is low, in that conditions, the high grade fever along with rigor and other feature of the toxemia may be there. Such abscess may occur in the visceral part where the blood supply is very good, and very huge blood supply, just like the organs, liver, spleen, kidney, they are very have the very good supply of the blood. So that's why this pyemic infections very chance to they get that blood clot, the emboli get the more time, more chance to present in these. In this liver sinuses or spleen or the kidney, that's why the pyemic abscess may be have good chance to present in these organs where the blood is going to remain longer time in that organs. So liver, spleen, and kidneys, pyemic abscess may be present. The most common site of the pyemic abscess is the liver. If this is present, if this pyemic abscess are present in vital organs, just like in the brain or heart, so in that condition is very fatal, and that causes the very fast deterioration condition of the patient, and patient may die also, because the diagnosis is very difficult. So today's diagnosis was the delayed diagnosis causes the fatality in this patient in these conditions. That's why this condition will fatal when the ischemic abscess present in the brain or the heart. The treatment, the principle of the treatment is that first early diagnosis is the key to success. Understand means if you diagnose that these cases very early, you can treat the conditions successfully. Second thing, search the source of infection, because we already discussed ischemic abscess are never primary focus. Primary focus may be somewhere else, and from there infection is traveling to this part. So you have to find out the primary focus. Until you are not removing the primary focus, patient is getting continuous infection from that focus. So you cannot treat the conditions. Third, suitable antibiotics as early as possible with the parenteral route. Means you have to give the antibiotic through IV route directly into the blood, so that the antibiotic start acting on over the bacterial organism. So bacteremia and septicemia condition can be controlled very early. And if it is possible, then you have to drain that abscess superficially, percutaneous. Just like the liver abscess, you can drain the liver abscess through ultrasonic guidance, aspiration of the abscess under ultrasonic guidance. So the principle of the treatment is, first you have to find out the diagnosis. First you have to diagnose the first case. Second, search for the source of the infections. Third, give the suitable antibiotics. And fourth, you try to drain the pus. Next condition is the cold abscess. So I don't think we can complete this. So we discuss in the next lecture.